Magdalena Cervantes, conocida como Nina. Cuando yo era muy niña, como 5 años, lo que tengo, una anécdota que tengo fue que él trabajaba, como tenía la edad de 14 o 15 años, trabajaba en una panadería y era en el segundo turno. Nosotros debíamos irnos a dormir, pero no nos dormíamos hasta que llegaba él, porque él nos traía una bolsa de pan, un costalito de pan, de esos costalitos que se cuelgan en el hombro los hombres cuando van al trabajo. Y no nos dormíamos hasta que llegaba, le hacíamos un festín al pan, y aunque mi mamá nos mandara a dormir, no nos dormíamos hasta que él llegaba. Y de Ramiro no se puede hablar más de que era un joven muy trabajador. También lo recuerdo en esa misma época de unos 5 años, que él, cuando mi mamá estaba enferma un día, él nos hizo una cazuela de frijoles fritos, era como las 5 de la mañana, porque se miraba el día oscuro todavía. Y antes de irse al trabajo, él nos dejó esa cazuela de frijoles fritos con un canasto de tortilla a un lado para que nosotros comiéramos. Eso es lo que yo recuerdo de él, que él fue siempre un muchacho preocupado por la vida de nosotros.
Yo soy Elisa, hermana de Ramiro. Él se vino para acá, para los Estados Unidos, el 49, y duró acá unos más de 2 años. Cuando regresó fue una alegría muy grande para todos, porque él era el hermano mayor. Él siempre estuvo cuidándonos, al pendiente, de ayudar a mi mamá mucho con nosotros, como el 56 o 57 fue también y estuvo con nosotros allá. Y pues él se apuró mucho de ver que necesitábamos mucha ayuda. Ellos pensaban, mi hermano y él, que pensaban que toda la familia nos juntáramos a vivir juntos acá en los Estados Unidos, que nos viniéramos. Éramos 6, de mí para abajo éramos 6, y mi mamá y mi papá éramos 8. Y pues ellos aceptaron que sí nos veníamos. Fue un viaje muy bonito. Vinimos en tren hasta Guadalajara y de allí nos vinimos en el camión hasta Mexicali. Allí fue mi hermano con un amigo, llevaron 2 carros para podernos levantar. Y cuando llegamos a Tijuana, nos tenían rentado un apartamento nuevo, nuevecito. Y de allí, nosotros podíamos ver todo Tijuana de arriba, de la terraza. Fue algo muy, muy lindo, porque ellos tener ese cuidado, esa atención, para ya tenernos listos donde vivir. Además, ellos se encargaban de llevarnos comida, cajas de comida de acá, de adentro. Duraron solamente 1 año en tramitar la documentación para todos. Al año cruzamos la línea para venir a los Estados Unidos. Fue un hermano que siempre se preocupó por mi mamá especialmente y por todos nosotros. Siempre hizo todo lo posible por vernos contentos y felices.
Soy un marinero. Thank you. porque ya sabe que el que navega regresará.
I just wanted to share a little bit of from memories of what the old was to us over here in the northern part of the state. He would drop by quite a few times. He was there for a lot of moments in our lives. I remember going over his house. I don't know how many of you remember this, and I don't know if it's true or not. He would tell us they would have some meat, and then I would say, "What is it?" And he said, "Es culebra." And I would go, is it or isn't it? So I never found out. Maybe one of you guys could tell me if it was. The last time he came was maybe, I want to say 6-7 years ago, maybe. And he made it to the Oakland house because he didn't know quite how to get over here. But he made that effort to keep the family together. And that goes back to how he wanted to keep the family together, bring everybody from Mexico to be together. He had that unity. He was that bond that said, we're all together. And if I want to share something, is that Dale was a simple man, but his love for us was with the simple things. Like Ama said, you know, bringing us little things was his way of showing he loved us, sharing with us, being with us. And I visit him. I got to see him the last time at the home, and telling me the stories of how he got that scar on his arm was so impactful that it really solidified what a great man he is, what a great person he was. And I am only sad that maybe some of us didn't get a chance to tell him, to say we appreciated you, we loved you, and we knew what you did for us. I know when I was there, I did get a chance to tell him, and I'm happy my girls got to meet him, got to go visit him. Because he was such a great part of my life, our life. So he will be missed, and thank you. Thank you, Theo, for everything. Bye.
Mi nombre es Manuel Cervantes. We came to the United States 1960. We started to live in Anaheim, and then after that, we moved up north California, because that's where my brothers work, and eventually I will work too in the fields. We came back to Norwalk, because we had purchased a house in Norwalk on September of 1963. The memories I have more about my brother Ramiro was that when we were together up north with him, He used to be a stimulant to us. He wanted us to be active, you know, and to work hard and to, you know, get out, you know, progress, you know. He wanted us to progress. He gave us a lot of encouragement. She was just a nice person, you know. Used to be very rigid though, very, you know, energetic, you know. In Mexico, you know, we had favorite, you know, this is what I remember the most, you know, in Mexico, you know, we used to go swimming in the river. Swimming in the river, and one time we took a trip to the mountains, you know. It was raining and everything. And then we were heading to the mountains. So we used to tell them, hey, are we going to go like this, ready to the mountains? They said, sure we are, yeah, sure we are. So we went to the mountains as far as we could. That's a good experience, you know, for me. Much later on, we took a trip to the mountains of Chihuahua.
Just you and him?
No, me, myself, Ramiro, and my brother Eddie, Everardo. This guy, we were looking for a treasure. Ramiro thought that he had like a map, you know, called a pergamino, something like that. And he showed us the site, supposedly, where the money was at, you know, where the treasure was set. So we went on a crazy trip, you know. Yeah. We started at about 10 o'clock p.m. We took a taxi to the bathroom of the mountain, and we unloaded there, and we took off, you know, the taxi guy took off, and we went to the walking up the mountain. So we spent all night on climbing the mountain, you know.
And you stayed the night up there?
Yeah, we spent the night up there, yeah. No, we actually eventually, we walked, you know, we would rest very little, you know. The following day, we would walk some more, climb the mountain some more. And we were looking for this place, you know, supposedly, you know, where the treasure was supposed to be. So anyway, in the process, we encountered wild animals, you know, especially one, I think it was like a mountain lion.
Oh, madre. I guess what I remember about my dad when we were small, I remember, you know, him cooking all the time. You know, he was always cooking for us. I remember him singing, you know, all the time, and he used to like it when I sang along with him. I remember that he loved, you know, growing vegetables, growing fruit, and liked to have us with him, helping him, you know, pick the fruit and appreciate. I remember him praying, teaching us to pray, you know, and, you know, teaching us all the things that he learned from Grandma. I used to think of him as the strongest man in the world, you know, and I would brag about that, that, you know, my dad was so strong that, you know, a steel beam could fall on him and he would be fine, you know, nothing could hurt him. I know, you know, that he, I guess, used to park, you know, near our school and keep an eye on us. And one time, you know, when I was walking home from school, a little boy from my class pushed me, and my dad, you know, jumped out of his car. I didn't know he was there, but he jumped out of his car and he grabbed the little boy and, you know, made sure he never did that again. He, you know, loved spending time with Beth, and, you know, we did, you know, would take him to the Huntington, to the zoo. And, you know, it's funny because she inherited his personality. Speaking so much about his personality and that stubbornness, while I see that it certainly, you know, gave us a lot of grief, I could also see that it's probably one of his greatest features, because if he hadn't been that stubborn, that hard-headed, and that independent, he never would have done what he did. He never would have left Mexico. He never would have made that journey. And how he, you know, endured that journey. And he did it at a time when he couldn't possibly be sure what he would expect. There was no one here in the United States that he knew. There were no phones. There was no way even that Grandma could keep track of him, or that she would know if he survived or if he didn't. And I think about how scary that was. And, you know, I know that if his personality had been any different, if he had, you know, been compliant, you know, he never would have done that. And he never would have, you know, made sure, you know, that his family all came to the United States, you know, to live here.
Yo soy Salvador Cervantes, hermano de Ramiro. Cuando yo conocí a mi hermano, pues él ya era adulto. Y lo conocí como, yo lo consideraba como un Superman. Tenía una energía y una fuerza tremenda. Creo yo que mi mamá nos quería a él y a mí más que a los demás. Pero no les digan, porque luego se enojan. Mi hermano fue el que sufrió al lado de mi mamá, para darnos de comer a los hermanitos, Martita, yo y los demás. Él, como el mayor, claro, acompañó a mi mamá durante casi toda su vida, ¿verdad? Ayudando a cuidarnos a nosotros, todos los demás, los niños menores. Ahora, cuando cruzamos la frontera, me acuerdo que llegamos a Anaheim y él ya nos tenía una casa rentada y tenía una mesa con mucha comida, corn flakes, pan, leche, hot dogs, increíble. Y pues él lo que nos pedía a nosotros era que nos portáramos bien, que estudiáramos y, claro, los mayores, que trabajaran. A mi hermano le costó mucho trabajo adaptarse a la sociedad, una sociedad moderna, no nomás americana, sino moderna, ¿verdad? Pero él aprendió a leer, a escribir, él aprendió inglés bastante para poder trabajar. Y un trabajo que tenía que hacer cálculos de las varillas de alambre, cálculos de aritmética. Y pues él todo lo aprendía para poder trabajar. Lo que sí tenía él era una idea muy clara de lo que debíamos de hacer. Y como ya he mencionado, era trabajar y estudiar. Nada de gangs, nada de gangs. Wanna be gangs. No quería que nos portáramos mal. My brother was like a pioneer. He was the pioneer. He's the reason that we are all here, because he's the one who trekked through the deserts, climbing on trains, catching rides, anyway, to get up here without any money, for the sole reason of earning money, working, working, so they can send some money to my mom so that the rest of us could be fed, literally. But can you imagine facing all of this alone as a teenager in an unknown world? So if he had not made that decision to come north, to brave it, OMG, none of us would be here. His idea was that we should all study, we should all work, but we should also help other people along the way. And that's, I think, where our family legacy comes in. Because I see my nieces and my nephews, you know, and when the time comes, they're ready to help me. We're ready to help each other. And I think it comes down from my mom, from him, a little bit from all the other relatives. Because sometimes when you're poor, that's what you have to do. You have to help each other. I think Ramiro would be happy to see that all of us, are successful. And he was. But he had a lot of trouble adapting himself to a modern society. So what can we do on his behalf or in his memory? Well, we can continue progressing. We can continue learning. We can continue engaging with people and helping out whenever we can. So I want to take that as a final point here. They remember that our family legacy should be about that, really, about helping others, but not forgetting about ourselves.